Okay, now we are going to see the another type of clustering, which is, what was the another type of clustering that we were going to see?
Hierarchical.
Hierarchical. Right? Now let's say, how is it happening? Again, this is a very confusing thing that people have made, and that is the reason dendrogram or hierarchical clustering people are not touching. By the way, this is not used so much in production, but since I have to teach you, and this is mostly is going to be the in reference to your interview, and at worst, if you have very less data points. Otherwise, dendrogram looks very cluttered. Okay, so let's start. Again, our approach is going to be very simple. Okay. See, there are two steps that is being used. Here also, we are going to see the distance. So let's say I'm talking about points like this. So we have points like this. Okay. Right. Let's say these are the points. Okay. Let's number them or forget about it. Okay. If you want to number it, let us quickly number them. I think I made too many points. It will take some more time. So let me quickly delete few points. Sare ho jayenge kya delete? Okay. Okay. Right. So let's number them. So let's say this is first point. Right, this is second point, this is third point, this is fourth point, this is fifth point, right? This is sixth, this is seventh, this is eighth. Any confusion till here?
No.
We are starting from bottom up. So what we are doing is, we are starting to make clusters of the two nearest points in the whole samples or whole feature space. So this is my feature space in which my points are lying.
Yes.
Correct. Now, which two points are nearest to each other in whole sample space?
One and two.
One and two. So I'll make a cluster. Let me use another color for it so that it is visible. Okay. So I'll make a cluster for these two. That means this is the distance between them I have calculated. This is the minimum. So I made a cluster out of it. Right. What is the second cluster that I can make of two nearest points?
Four, five.
Okay. So this is another cluster, right? What is the third two nearest points?
Six, seven.
Okay. So I made 6, 7. Right. How many clusters we have?
Three.
Okay. Now you see, three is nearest to this cluster or this cluster?
Four, five.
So three will be acquired by 4, 5, right? Okay. Now 8 will be acquired by this particular cluster, right? Now how many clusters we have? 1, 2, 3. Correct. Now this 1, 2 will get merged to this particular cluster. Now how many clusters we have?
Two.
Now if I don't like the decision tree, if we don't stop it, it will keep on merging with each other. Now this will merge to this particular cluster and will whole become, the whole data point will become one cluster. Understood? So we are going bottom up. Now you will say, then Dhruv, what is the use of this if it is at last going to be one cluster? Right? You understood how we are making very easy, right? But this question remained unanswered, right? What is the optimum number of cluster, or how do we decide, right? How do we then, the cluster is itself not happening because at last all the points are merging and forming one cluster. Yes or no? This question remained unanswered, right? Till now. Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay. Now, before answering that question, let us revise what we have just done in the form of a, you can say a kind of graph, right? A graph I'm just making. Clear? So I can put the x-axis here also. Sorry, let me instead put the x-axis here. For you to understand, right? Again, on y-axis, I am putting the distance, right? And on x-axis, I am just plotting the points. So it is better that I'm just removing the x-axis, okay? And just for visibility purpose, no other way. So let's say here I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? So I'm just trying to make the dendrogram. 1, 2, 3, or let me use another color again. Please mute yourself if you're not speaking. Kaun sa color kare yaar? This color. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 points were there. Yes, no?
Yes.
Yes.
Now the distance between 1 and 2 was minimum. That is the reason what actually happened. The dendrogram of 1 and 2 formed for the first. Now on y-axis, if this is the distance, so this line will tell us the distance between 1 and 2. So this formed one cluster. Yes or no?
Yes.
Then what actually happened? 4 and 5, right? So 4 and 5 had a bit more distance than A and B. So my height of 4 and 5 is a bit higher. Okay. Please pardon if my, you know, thing is, this thing is not properly. Okay. What was the third cluster we made? 6, 7, right? Which was further a bit more than 4 and 5. So I'm making a bit higher because y-axis is the distance, right? So I'm just making higher. Okay. After that, what happened? 8 was merged. Yes or no?
3 was merged.
3 was merged first?
Yes. 3 was merged, yes. 4 and 5.
I think since 8 was a bit more, you know, nearer than 3 will happen later than 8, right? Oh, if you think okay. The distance is less, right? So let's say 8 actually merged, right? Clear?
Yes, yes.
Now 6, 7, 8 is one cluster. After that, 3 was merged to 4 and 5, right? So let us merge 3 to 4 and 5. Now 3, 4 and 5 is one cluster. 6, 7, 8 is one cluster. 1, 2 is one cluster, right? As per our understanding, right? After that,
bro,
1 and 2.
One thing, like as you represent now, it's like a 3 merged first and 8 merged later, right?
See, as per your understanding, whatever you feel merged first, I just took a random example, correct?
Okay. Yeah.
If you think this merged first, you can make this first, okay? Clear? Conceptually, okay. You should be correct, okay?
Okay.
Why I, cut it there is because here, I can see that this distance is a bit more than this cluster's distance, right? If you think this is less, then obviously this will merge first, okay? Doesn't matter, okay? Just you have to keep a track that this length should denote the distance. If it is less, it should be shorter, okay?
Yeah.
Now, what I'm saying is 1, 2 was merged to this particular 3, 4, 5 wala, right? So I merged this together. Now I have how many clusters? This whole as one, this whole as one. Now, if I don't, if I don't kind of stop it, then what it will do is it will further merge and will become one cluster. So if you see at this point, at this distance, everything is one cluster.
Yes.
Whole point is actually one cluster. First, tell me how I joined the points you understood.
Right.
Yes. Yes.
Very easy, right? Very easy. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now let us understand. Let us understand how we can decide how many clusters I need. Okay. Right? How many clusters I need? Again, I can use elbow curve to understand how many clusters I want, right? Let's say I need 3 clusters. So what I'll do is I'll try to detach. So let's see, I detach from top bottom, right? So I just detach here. So how many clusters I'll have?
2.
One here and one here, right? Let's say I need 3 clusters. Then what will I detach? I will detach this or this. Which one I'll detach?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
This I'll have to detach because this is just, I mean, lesser than the total, right? So based on distance, I'll detach. So now I'll have 3 clusters, one for this, and this is detached. So another this and third this, right? If I need fourth cluster, 4 clusters, right? So I'll detach from here. So 1, 2 will be 1, 3, 4, 5 will be 1, 6, 7 will be 1, and 8 will be another cluster. If I need 5, I'll further subdivide and detach. So this is top to bottom approach. Correct? You understand what I'm saying? Another way of doing is bottom up, the way we started. Yes or no? Correct?
Yes.
If I need 3 clusters, so I'll do this, this, and whenever I'll achieve 3, I'll stop there. Whenever I need 2, I'll stop when I found this and this. When I need 1, 1 is not of no use, but still I'm just for the sake, I'm telling you, if I need 1 cluster, then I'll keep it grow till it becomes whole as 1 cluster. So that is nothing but bottom up. And this is top down. Clear? Yes. Any confusion?
No, it's clear.
Okay. Now, on the basis of the technique, bottom up or top down, it is divided it into 2 parts again. So, my bad. Sorry. So hierarchical clustering on the basis of whether I'm doing top down or bottom up is divided into 2 part. Let's see if I'm doing bottom up. Then it is agglomerative called, right? Agglomerative clustering. Right? And if I'm doing top down, then the name is very familiar. It is called divisive. Why? Because if you see, we are dividing, right? So divisive clustering, or you can tell as agglomerative hierarchical clustering, divisive hierarchical clustering. Okay. I'm just keeping it as it is, you, so that it is easier for you to understand. Clear? Any confusion till here?
No.
Okay. Now, let me sum up for you. Now, if someone asks you, okay, what is the difference between hierarchical clustering and k-means clustering? So this becomes very important, right? Or let's first talk about the difference between agglomerative, and then we will go with the final, you know, what is the difference of k-means and hierarchical. Okay, first of all, since just now I did, okay, so top down and bottom up, or agglomerative and divisive. Can you tell me the difference? So agglomerative and divisive, all right? What is the difference?
In agglomerative, you know how many clusters you need in the beginning itself. So you don't have to
see. First point, very first point is what? This is bottom up. Right? And this is top down approach. Right?
Right.
Right. Here, if you understand, each observation starts in its own cluster. Yes, no?
Yes.
Right? And what is actually happening? Pairs of clusters are merged. Right? This is what happening. What is happening? When pairs of clusters are merged, when we move up the hierarchy. Up in the hierarchy. Right. Okay. Understood? Any confusion till here?
No.
Okay. What is indivisible? First of all, it is top-down approach. After that, here, if you see from our perspective, all observation, so observation starts in one cluster. And if we are coming from top down, what is the number of clusters?
One,
right? And that is what you have to tell, correct? So divisive clustering, right? And what is happening? Here it is merging and here it is splitting. Correct?
Yes.
Splits are performed recursively. As we move, where? Top or down?
Down.
Down.
Down the hierarchy. Right?
Yes.
One more point you can write here, that parent is visited first. Yes or no? So if you consider that concept, that these two are children, this is the parent. Here we don't have any node or such concept, but if you understand, this whole becomes the children of, you know, one cluster, then further subdivision. So basically, if you are coming from top to down, then my parent is visited first. And if I'm going bottom to top, children or sub component is visited first. Yes or no?
Yes.
So this here, the parent is visited first. Here you can write sub component is visited first and then move to parents. So basically we are starting with the very, two points, yes or no? And then we are making the parent. Yes, no?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Okay. So you got the difference. Okay. Now tell me, once we have understood what is hierarchical clustering, right? Can you tell me what is the difference, right? What is the difference in hierarchical and k-means? See, I haven't taught you, so I'll tell you. So
maybe the optimization.
That is one of the thing, right? So see, I'll tell you something which is just for your reference. So which particular clustering do you think is more complex to handle?
Hierarchical,
right? So that is going to be my first point. hierarchical clustering cannot handle big data well. Big data, not in the terms of that big data, but large data, you can understand, right? Large data well, but K means can. That is because of its nature, right? Because it has to visit each and every point. Yes or no?
Correct.
Correct. And K means what we are trying to do is we are trying to find out the distance, and based on that we are forming the cluster. Yes or no? And we are shifting after, you know, each iteration. So if I have to give you a brief, so time complexity, and what is time complexity? In computer science, most of the algorithms are decided based on the time complexity and space complexity, right? I'm not going in depth of that. That is more into computer science domain, but I'm just telling you that will give you an idea. So time complexity of K means, right? K means is order of N, right? While time complexity of hierarchical is order of N square. So obviously more time will be required in doing a hierarchical, right? And then it is very high, square term is there. Understood? That is first difference. If someone asks you, you can tell. Obviously more time, and this is order, N and N square in hierarchical. But where hierarchical can be used? So if you see properly, in K means, sometimes results are not always reproducible. That means it may happen that due to the movement of points, right? Some points are still showing, you know, some points are still showing, not the movement of point, my bad, movement of my centroid or movement of my food truck, okay? And the customers, they are still purchasing with that particular, and that may not be reproducible, right? That means in another iteration, if someone else does on the same data set, they may get, for a few points, they may get some other clusters, I may get some other cluster. And usually that happens in K-means, right? But here in the terms of hierarchical clustering, it is always reproducible. Why? Because we are considering the distance and we are actually plotting it. So let's see, if I have to split, it will act, if anyone also will do, they will just divide it into, if they split from here, they will divide the same points. So this will become as one cluster, this will become as another cluster. You understand? So if to sum up, in hierarchical clustering, so I'm writing it like this. So results are not always reproducible, right? Reproducible in K means. Another reason is because we start randomly, right? We randomly put our food truck somewhere, right? But here we start with the logic that we are, you know, in hierarchical, we have a logic of start. What is that logic? That we are forming the cluster of the nearest, which is nearest two points. Yes or no? The distance between two points should be nearest. Yes or no? So I'm writing it here. Right? Any confusion? So what do I, again, I'm repeating. Listen carefully. So let's say if I did this, and if I tell you that, okay, can you do this for me? So what you will do? You will also use the same concept, right? So if two dis, two points are with this much distance, they will always be at that much distance. Yes or no? Correct? So you will also do this dendrogram itself, right? So any confusion? No. But in k-means, I randomly put my trucks at starting at this and this point. You can put trucks at in a straight line here, here and here, right? So let's say I run it for n number of iteration. So still some point are coming out to be from another, some point are still taking from second one instead of one or like that, right? So that is based on where I have put, right? Yes or no? What I mean to say is, for example, I put my food truck here, here and here, though I put randomly, but this randomness cannot be reproduced, right? So you can put here, here and here. So let's say if I run for 10 iteration, it came here. You run for 10 iteration, it is still not coming here. It is looking like this. So if I consider this point, these points in my data set have sorted and these points are now a part of second cluster. But let's say this is how your data set looks like in after 10 iteration, then this point will be still showing as first cluster. Yes or no?
Yes.
So that is the reason it is not reproducible. So another people may start randomly and then after n iterations, they are still at some other point. I after 10 iteration, maybe at some other point. Yes or no? And that is why it is not reproducible. But it is reproducible in hierarchical clustering. Okay. I started with application. Can someone give me another application after we have finished this? Can someone give me another application where you can use it? If you remember, we started with the use cases like Google News, movie recommendation, launching a product, right? Marketing strategy, forming marketing strategy, right? Other use cases can be like, for example, recommendation engine, right? Market basket analysis. So what is market basket analysis? I explained in the first class, if you remember. So usually, your tea, your sugar and milk are put together. Yes or no?
Yes.
Why is it put together? In some way or the other, it is related. That relation can be anything, but it is related. That is the reason that is made as one cluster, one group. Yes or no?
Correct.
Bolo na, yes or no?
Yes.
Market segmentation is another thing. Anyone from sales or marketing here in my class?
So I am from sales and marketing. Yes.
Can you explain for other people in the audience, including me, how do you think market segmentation, and can you relate market segmentation with the clustering that we study?
Okay, I'll try. What I am doing right now in my bank. Okay.
Think
there are.
Take your time.
Okay, if I'm deputy branch manager of ICICI, Aundh branch. Mm-hmm. So if we are having, let's say, 3,000 customers. Mm-hmm. So out of them, 1,500 customers are average customers. Mm-hmm. I mean, they are having portfolio of mostly 5 lakhs to 10 lakh. Mm-hmm. Some are... more than that, 20 lakhs to 30 lakhs having portfolio of that amount. And some are very elite customer. Mm-hmm. Like they are having portfolio of minimum 1 crore. Okay. So according to that, we'll segment the customer like wealth customers. Mm-hmm. So as per their requirement, you cannot pitch PMS product to average customer because PMS is an elite product. Mm-hmm. You must invest at least 50 lakhs rupees in your portfolio. Okay. At the same time, if there are some traders, so for them, we are having product starting from rupees 900. Mm-hmm. And you cannot pitch that product to elite customers because they don't care how much brokerage you are giving to the company. Mm-hmm. So these segmentations are done on the basis of their portfolio and what the service we are providing to customers.
Cool. Yeah, thank you. So you understood, yeah. This is how we will segment. Now, just to add to what he said, and I just want to tweak it a bit. He said there are, he what he did, knowingly or unknowingly, he put all his customers into three groups, right? Elite customers and someone with, you know, medium earnings and someone with less earnings, right? But what can be done further is, let's say if I somehow see that, as per my experience, the medium range has too many people. Yes or no?
Mm-hmm.
You have to understand psychology. I told, when we were studying normal distribution, what I said, people with medium IQ or medium earnings will be more in number. Extreme left, extreme right are very less in numbers.
Right.
Yes.
Correct. Now, that means there is a possibility that I can divide the medium sized customers still into another two groups by any way. So how many clusters will have? Instead of three, I can have four clusters. But how did I change from three to four is from my understanding. So obviously in clustering, everything machine is not doing, everything you are also not doing. So there is a combination, and like other algorithm also, here also we keep the mind. But if someone asks you, what is, how do you find the value of K? You can say that, see, we get the optimized value of K using WCSS or WSS curve, or it is also called elbow curve. Sometimes, see, you understand, sometimes they don't know WSS. I tell you, if you go in depth of elbow curve, right, they are not knowing these concepts, right? This particular thing I told, right? This concept they are not knowing. They are knowing that, yes, at some point, this thing will be less. But if you ask, what is this thing, right? They are not able to explain. But now you know properly, right? So you can explain it to them. And you can say that, see, optimal number of cluster from elbow curve or WSS curve, I got as 3 or 4 or 5. But we discussed it with our business or our client, and we told that this is the optimum number of clusters, and this is how the cluster will look like. They said that, no, the bigger cluster, right, which was actually happening, to divide it into two further clusters, right? So instead of 5, we got 6. You got my point?
Yes.
So not always you will use this, you know, exact this. It can be less than this also, or more than this also, a bit, right? But not so more, correct? That WSS curve gave you 3 and you are using 10 as a cluster. No, not that much also, okay? Is it clear? Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll quickly save it and then we'll go further. And save it as PDF. Okay. Now, see, we are going to start the clustering, and we'll do with two data set. One data set we'll use for hierarchical, and another data set we'll use for k-mean. Right? Understand this hierarchical clustering. I just want to showcase you. But even for smaller data set, it becomes very cluttered. You understand? It becomes very cluttered. And that is the reason it is not mostly used in production, right? If you have to, you know, see how the joins happen and what is the optimum number of cluster, what should be it be, and how the split will look like, then obviously you can plot, okay? And then you can just, snip it at a particular level to see how it looks like, right? Delink it from the parent to see it, how it looks like. But you usually you won't use hierarchical clustering in your day-to-day life, at least for large data set, right? First of all, it looks cluttered. Another thing is, obviously, it is time complexity is very much. It's not even 2n, it is n square, right? Coming here. So we are just importing the libraries Okay. After that, we are getting the data, shopping data. Now, what is the shopping data looks like? We have customer ID, right? Gender, instead of gender, it is written honor. Please ignore that. Age, annual income in $1,000, right? And spending score, 1 to 100. Now you understand this. Usually what happens is, based on your spending that you do, okay, you are scored by a particular, let's say Walmart or Amazon, right? You can think it in the term as a, yesterday I was telling CLTV, right? Customer lifetime value. That particular pointers you can also say, right? So usually spending score plus your loyalty, in if put together, that you know, that is how the CLTV is calculated. Okay, you can see the formula. I think it is more related to that domain, but I am saying that that is how you are judged. You understand? Have you seen that if you are an if you are a good customer from Amazon or Flipkart, and if you just put a refund or something like that, sometimes they just tell you to keep the product and still they refund you the money. Has this happened to anyone?
Yes.
This happened, right? Yeah. How do they do that? They just see your, you know, your points, your spending points or your lifetime value, so that you as a customer is more valuable than if, even if they are spending 500, 1,000, 2,000 on you, right? So that you are loyal to them as a loyal customer, right? You understand? So that is what the data set looks like. Any confusion in the data set?
No. No doubt.
Okay. Now again, describe, you will use pre-processing. Again, here I'm not doing. Okay. Pre-processing, usually I did it in few notebooks, and for further, tomorrow we have a separate class for doing that. Here the concept is to understand, here the purpose is to understand the concept, right? So I'm focusing on that. So don't always expect that this pre-processing, why is not it there, right? Pre-processing is required when you are doing a data set right from the scratch, okay? If you have to understand the algorithm, not always you will go with the pre-processing. For example, let's say if you have to practice 10 algorithm in this whole week, okay? So you will do pre-processing differently, right? Differently as in you will do separately pre-processing EDA. And if it is done, you will use instead the clean data to understand the algorithm if you only have to work on algorithm. If you have to only understand the pre-processing, you will do the pre-processing on different data sets. Got my point? Okay, coming back. This is how the description looks like. Okay, you all know what these mean. So again, I'm not repeating. Okay, now I am just filtering this data, right? What I'm doing here, can someone explain me?
Filtering columns 3 to 5.
Anyone else? Tell me in the terms of this.
We are only taking the annual income and spending score of all rows.
Annual income and spending score. Okay.
Yes.
But someone said 3 to 5. That means 3, 4, and 5. Correct?
Yeah, here I think there is no 5. Right?
But why you said 3 to 5? What? See.
It does not include the 5.
It does not include 5.
5 minus 1.
I have discussed this in my pre-processing class. Yes or no? How to filter?
Yes.
यार भूल जाते हो क्या तुम लोग? This is bare minimum. Okay, ठीक है. I'm not telling you guys anything. Okay, but keep a check on all these things. Okay, how tough is it to remember that the indexing in Python starts from
zero.
Right. So obviously this thing will increase, right?
Yes.
You yourself are saying there is no fifth column like that. Okay, so you have to understand how to do the filtering or how to select the column. At least you understand on that, how to reverse the string, work on all those simple things. Okay, so that you are able to churn the data properly. Okay, going ahead, let's run the dendrogram based hierarchical clustering. Okay, this is how the dendrogram looks like. Are you able to figure out the x-axis? No, you cannot. Okay. No. But you will have, but you understand what is happening, right? If I zoom it for you, right? You are able to understand, correct? No, it is not zooming like this. So I'll have to get there. So you got what it means, right? So let's talk about it. Tell me if I have to split it into two clusters, where will I detach?
At the top.
Here. Okay. Now I have this as one cluster, right? And this as another cluster, cluster one, cluster two. Okay. Now if let's say if I have to make it as a third cluster, I mean three clusters, which one I'll use? Which one I'll detach?
The right side.
This blue, one, right?
Blue color.
This was at the first place. This I did at the second detachment. So now what is the cluster? This is whole as one. This whole as two. This whole as three. Okay. Tell me. Now if I need three clusters, then?
Three,
four clusters.
Left green one, left upper set green.
Green.
So this will be one. This whole left green is, left out green is second. This red is third and this is fourth. Okay. Clear?
Yes.
Now, what, okay, you understand. Now, if I need fifth, so there is, if there was another cluster having same distance or more than that, that would have been the priority. But here it is not there, right? So that is the reason it is easier for us to understand, where to detach, right? Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now, if you see, it is very easier for us to visualize, at least not the points, but it is easier for us to visualize. Let's see if I'm working on a particular, if I'm working on a particular data set, right? If I'm working on a particular data set, if I want to visualize, how can I go ahead, with splitting, right? What can I do? I can start splitting from the top, right? Because again, okay. Tell me one thing, from agglomerative and divisive, what do you think is more easier for us?
Divisive
or agglomerative? Think about it.
Agglomerative is easier.
See, you understand. Agglomerative or divisive?
Agglomerative.
I think divisive. You understand? Because agglomerative, we have to individually go to each point, then see the distance from all the points, right? And then find out, let's say there are n points, right? So let's say there are three points, A, B, C. So you have to find out distance of A from B, distance of A from C, right? Clear? Yes or no?
Yes.
Then B from C, B from A. So this is N into N minus one, right? For a single point, correct? Or N. So if it is one point, so if this is three, so three into two, six. So three, N into N minus one, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So if you understand, if there are so many points, then the combination may go on and on. Yes or no?
Yes.
You'll have to find out the distance. Then not only find out the distance, then you will have to sort this. And then you'll have to start making the clusters. And then bottom up you have to go. Is it required for each point? No. Because at most what we will do? We will need 5 clusters, 6 clusters, 10 clusters, 15 clusters, like that. Not more than that, right?
Right.
It is better to go from top down. This is my perception. If you have any other thing to tell me, you can tell. Okay. Yes or no? Okay. I have a quick assignment for you. You see here, there is this thing, method is equal to what? Okay. So basically, we talk about distance, right? So similarity, I said, perception of similarity. So here we are taking the distance. So there are multiple methods in which we try the linkage. The methods are, okay, let me use it here. Just give me a moment. So the methods, linkage method, right? There are the linkage method called single linkage, right? Right? Complete linkage. We have Ward's linkage, which we are using here, right? And let's say average linkage. Then we have, complete is done. Centroid linkage. Now, what are these things? So basically these linkage method work on the similarities that I said. Sometimes it is distance. Sometimes it also work on the dissimilarity, right? Closest pair of clusters. Now, since you know that the distance calculation can be used from different formulas, right? Sometimes you have Euclidean distance, sometimes you have Manhattan distance, sometimes you have another distance metric. So all the linkage work on a particular similarity matrix or similarity way, right? For example, in one linkage, I can work out with one distance matrix. In another, I can work with another, right? So my task or assignment here is, you can go ahead and read about it. And I want everyone to be discussing this with themselves. Then you would be able to remember it for longer. Can I expect this?
Yes.
Euclidean distance, yes. How many of you know?
Yes, I know.
This is what, right? Euclidean distance is nothing but Pythagoras theorem, right? We are going to talk about it in our next algorithm, okay? About the distance, two of the distance matrix, but read about it. Clear? Can I expect this?
Yes.
Okay. So, clustering. We'll say replace. Okay, cool. Okay. Now let's go back to our. Okay. This is how it looks like. Now, once I have just formed or just found out the dendrogram. See, dendrogram making is very easy because till now there is no clustering involved. What is dendrogram? Dendrogram only tells how the linkage has happened from bottom up. Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Currently, we haven't decided how many clusters we would be needing, right? But I'm just telling you that this is how we will go. For now, just ignore that how I came to know the number of clusters, but just assume that I need n clusters or number of clusters as 5 for this particular problem. In K-means, we are going to see the WCSS or elbow curve. For now, just assume that number of clusters is needed 5. So even before going that, if I need 5 number of clusters as 5, where will we delink? So the first one will delink here, so it will divide into 2. Another we will delink here, so we have 3. Then we delinked here, so we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and we have delinked here, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Any confusion?
No.
That means if I use any other color, should I use? green bhi hai. Okay, let's use this. This is one cluster. Yes, no?
Yes.
This is another cluster. This is third cluster, right? This is fourth and this is fifth. So cluster 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If I had to divide it into 4, 2 and 3 would have been one cluster. 1, this 2, this 3 and this 4. Yes or no? So now I am saying that we have to use 5 clusters. We have to divide it into 5 clusters. So all we have to do is, let's say agglomerative clustering I am using here, not divisive. Okay. And n clusters, 5 I have given. Affinity is Euclidean. So distance matrix that I am using is nothing but Euclidean. Distance to find out distance between two points. I can find out from any distance, distance metric. Here I am using Euclidean. Okay. What is Euclidean distance? Pythagoras theorem. Z is equal to x square plus y square under root. Okay.
Yes.
Now, if I did that and after I predict on the data set, then what will happen? These are my clusters, right? So five clusters, let's say 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, that is 5 clusters, right? And if I plot the clusters, this is how it looks like. So let me quickly show you this. So this is one cluster, right? This is another cluster, right? This is third cluster. This whole is fourth, right? And this is one cluster. Yes or no?
Yes.
So altogether 5 clusters we have divided. If you would have divided 4, I don't know where it would have divided. Where it would have merged, but let's assume that these two would have been merged to one. Okay. Correct. So 1, 2, 3, and 4. If further, then let's say these three would have been one. So 1, 2, 3. If further, then these four would have been one. So 1 and 2. If all, then all as one cluster. Got my point?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. That is how it looks like in the form of cluster. Okay. So, and
is there any significance for this scale x and y as you want to compare?
I did not get your question. What is scale?
See, x and y.
No. Okay. Sorry. See, you understand. So significance of scale is very much in this because we are talking about the distance. So if the scale is not there, how do you get to know this point is very far from this point? Or this point is nearer to this point? That is the reason these are similar in one way or the other. Yes or no?
Yes. Yeah.
And that is how the similarity. See, understand this as a computer. How does an algorithm understands the similarity? Mathematically only, right? Feeling thode aayega usko. You understand? So how does the similarity work? You have to give some formula. What is that formula? Calculate the distance. If the distance is nearer, then you can consider it as similar. Then they may ask you, your algorithm may ask you, okay, tell me how much distance. That is where you decide. So if you understand, when you are delinking here, in a way, you are telling that you don't want this much distance. Everyone understanding what I'm saying? So let's say this was the distance only, no?
Yes.
When I'm delinking here, in a way, I'm telling that this distance is very far.
Yes.
Okay. Let me go to very initial setup. Okay. These were our points. Okay. So I'm saying, just one second. Hello. Yeah, they call Sunday also. Okay, coming back. Sorry. So let's say. I'm saying that this I formed as one cluster. This I formed as, let's say, in the second iteration, these two are formed. further this was formed, correct? After that, this was merged, then this was merged, then this was merged. Before it was going to be merged here, I said, no, you cannot merge. Why? Because this distance is too much. That is the reason we have two clusters.
Yes.
Correct? If, let's say, if that distance is more, I would have stopped it. If either of these two is more, let's say this was more. So I would have stopped it here. I said, no, this distance is too much. Then I would have 1, 2, 3, and 4 clusters. If this distance was also more, then I would have stopped to merge it here. Then we would have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 clusters. Correct? So similarly, if we keep on decreasing the distance between these points as a similar, then obviously we'll have closely packed points and number of clusters would be more.
Yes.
In a way, indirectly, we are telling how much distance I need. Right? And how will I perceive the distance? When I plot a scatter plot, right? Scatter plot basically tells you distance between two points. Yes, no?
Correct.
And in the scatter plot, the scale of the plot becomes very important. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Let's go ahead and study the k-means cluster, which you would be using mostly. Okay. So for this, let's say we have the similar kind of data, but which is from our side, which called customer spend data, right? So the data set looks something like this. Okay. Something like this, that we have customer ID, name, average monthly spent, okay, number of visits in total, right? How many apparel item they have purchased? By the way, this should be food and vegetable. Fruit and vegetable. I thought that food and beverages. No, so it's fine. So FNV item means fruit and vegetable item, staple items, right? So in a way, I am trying to gather as much knowledge as I can from my customer's visit. Yes or no? If I'm a smart retailer, this is what I'll do.
Yes.
And that is why data scientists are hired in Walmart, Flipkart. Obviously, they do a lot of work, but this is also one of the things, right? You will be working on the real-time retail analytics, right? So you will be basically working on the sales data, which they collect because they know how much sales has happened, how much you have purchased individually, correct? So you can do analytics on their seller profile also, as well as their products also, as well as their, their customers also. On the basis of that only, they usually give the offers, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now coming back. So what we are saying is this is the data set we have. Okay. And now description I have got from the data. I'm not explaining that. Okay. Feature scaling. Whenever we are talking about the distance to calculating the distance, it becomes very important that you scale the variable, right? Scale the variable. Otherwise, the distance of one can be so much. Because of the change in the unit, it becomes very important for you to do the feature scaling. I have explained about it in detail when we studied the pre-processing. Okay. Still, if you have any confusion, you may ask currently, okay, why scaling is required. Is it clear why scaling is required?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's go ahead and see how the WSS plots look like. Okay. WSS plot. This is our elbow curve, right? This is our elbow curve in which what I'm taking WCSS inertia. So that particular diameter, which we consider is nothing but inertia. We call it in the form Esquilon call it inertia. Okay. So we are just appending the inertia for my clusters. So I'm just increasing the cluster. Okay. Now it is up to you how many clusters you want to try out. For now, I am trying out, let's say in the range of 1 to 11, you can try out anything, right? You can try here. I'm trying out 10. You can try out 15 clusters. It is up to you. But what is one concept? Even if you are finding out or trying out with 15 clusters, you would be looking out for the that elbow, right? Where is the elbow? This is the elbow or this is the elbow?
Four.
It depends, right? It depends. Usually if you see, it depends first of all whether you want to take three or four. Both can be correct. Again, see, always remember, do not give any black and white answers in black and white answers in data science. Always remember, you can say that it depends. If I say it depends, can you complete the sentence on which thing it will depend?
No.
Whether three or four. Based on my business problem, right? Yes. Correct. So that means, let's say at three, the inertia is around 10, and at four, the inertia is 5, right? So if I, by increasing one cluster, if my business is fine with getting this much, or if my business says, no, three clusters is fine, even though my client is okay with having that much inertia extra, okay, or that much distance, okay? So it depends. You can take three also, four also. But with a 5, 4 is a good number. Clear? Understood? But still, I'll take 3 just to break the barrier. Okay, so that you are not generalizing everything. You understand? Always you have to think about it, that you will take the elbow. Yes, I know the elbow happened at 3. Some people have different concept. They say that elbow is where there is sudden decrease, or you can say that it was falling shortly but started to bend a bit. So that is actually happening at 3. So with that concept, you can take 3. Are you getting what I'm trying to say?
Yes.
And that is the reason it is called an elbow curve, is where, because it is bending. The first bend, usually in significant bend, basically you may consider that also, but you can also take 4, you can also take 5. Believe me, you can take, right? It is up to you. This elbow method is just to guide you, not to override your concept of clustering. Okay, now 3, 4, and 5, anything you can use, okay, based on the business problem. Okay, so what is then you will ask, what is you do, Dhruv, in let's say production? What we do is, yesterday we discussed no free lunch, so we build clusters 3 also, 4 also, 5 also, right? We suggest that this is what it is happening to be looking like after we have three clusters, 4 and 5 clusters, let's say. Okay, then we sit with domain expert, and then we sit with the marketing team, and then we decide whether we have to go in the market with 4 clusters, 3 clusters, or 5 clusters. Correct? Because you understand, if you're dividing your marketing strategies into one extra cluster, let's say earlier they decided to go ahead with 1, 2, 3, and 4 cluster, and then you said, no, let's go with 5. This extra cluster will cost them millions of dollars, right? It is up to them. If you can convince them that no, this will get some money for you, fetch some money for you, then only they will go. Otherwise, they will go, no, let's do 4. Instead, let's do 3. So that optimization also is in the mind, okay? But yes, you can take the help of this elbow method to guide whether you want 3, 4, or 5. Clear? Any confusion?
No, it's clear.
Okay, now let's go ahead with the cluster information. So see, you understand, if you are going ahead with clustering, there are two ways to showcase, right? What is the individual person belongs to, right? And which cluster he belongs to, right? Which cluster a particular individual person, if new customer comes, where does he belong? But there is one more important thing which can be gathered, that we can read about the collective information of a cluster, right? That means, what is my first cluster? So kind of a summary of one cluster. So here, if you see, summary of customer ID doesn't make any sense, but yes, this thing make any sense. That if we consider average monthly spend, my cluster 1's average monthly spend is more than 5,000. Cluster 2's average monthly spend is around 2,000 plus. And cluster 3's average monthly spend is 7,000 plus. Clear? So clearly, we have three clusters. Number of visits. So average number of visit. See, obviously, number of visit is going to be quantized, right? 4, 5, 6, it is not going to be 3.5. But if you take of overall cluster, right, it may come in the point. So do not worry that why is it coming in the point. Okay, clear? So that is what I'm saying. Now, apparel item, how many apparel item? So usually if you take, this is not the average. So if you see, this is kind of giving you usually how much the cluster has spent, cluster has worked on, right? Now, apparel item, if you see, this particular customer has mostly, I mean, this particular cluster has mostly purchased the apparel item. This particular cluster has mostly purchased the vegetable or fruit item, right? This particular, cluster has mostly purchased, first and second. So these two have mostly purchased the staple items, right? So this is how you will get the information and then make the marketing strategy based on the clusters, right? Here I have made three. If you would have made four, then fourth cluster would have been there, then all the values, right? Maybe this would have been divided into two parts and then we would have got four. If five, then another one, right? You understand? This is how we study about the clusters. So no rocket science, we have just group by cluster. All of you know how to do group by in Python?
Yes.
Anyone who doesn't know? If you don't know, then please go ahead and study. These are the things you will be actually using, right? Actually using, okay? Clear?
Yes.
Now, if I just put it the way we discussed, if we assign it to our data set, each individual customer will be assigned with a cluster. Yes or no?
Yeah.
Only three clusters. So cluster 1, cluster 2, cluster 3. Right? That are the numbers. Right? You can rename it to ABC or market strategy 1, strategy 2, strategy 3. It is up to you. So let's start. Today we are going to, we are going to see one algorithm called K nearest neighbors. Right? K nearest neighbor. Now this algorithm is very easy, very small algorithm, but becomes very important due to a few reasons. First of all, the name looks like, and in short, by the way, this is called KNN, right? The name looks like K means, yes or no?
Yes. Yeah.
Right? Hence, people usually get confused and relate it with K means. The reason I am teaching both in the same day because so that there is no confusion. Clear? So that we clear the confusion as it is. Because currently you have just now learned K-means, so it is easier for you to relate or disrelate with it. Okay, let's start. As always, we will break down the concept from very beginning. Okay, so let's start. What is the first thing that we do in all of the algorithm? Tell me, what is the first thing that we do? We just work out on the names, right? What does the name mean, right? In any particular algorithm, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Before I explain the name, let me remind you guys. In childhood, if you remember, we used to be judged by our company. Yes or no? At least at that point of time, even now, but usually in our childhood, we used to be judged by the company we used to keep, right? For example, if I am in the company of good people and I was considered as good boy, otherwise a bad boy, right? That is how it used to be in our society.
Kind of.
Right?
Yes.
The same goes with KNM. Same goes with KNM, right? So by keeping this a secret, how it is, same with KNM, let me first define it. So like K-means is a clustering algorithm, but KNN is a supervised algorithm, right? And this is used for classification mostly, right? Can be used for regression also, but mostly used for classification, okay? Correct? Okay, now you will say that, Dhruv, by the thing that you started, what is the aim of this algorithm, right? So let me write down the aim for you so that you remember, right? It says, the aim of this algorithm is it identifies, okay, right. Identifies data points. So identifies data points that are separated into different categories. And it tries to classify, right? It tries to classify the new sample or new data point from the set, and it is the classification is based on nearest neighbors. Okay. Let me explain how does it work, right? So the question how does it work, right? Now you understand that let's say if I'm talking about a point, a class of a point, what I'm saying is, I am saying that, let's say someone is asking me, Dhruv, give me what is the class of this particular point is. This is a new point. Can you tell me what is the class of this particular point? I'll say, and why this becomes very easy is, what I'll say is, hey, let's say my manager's name is X. So I'll say, Mr. X, what we can do is, I can see the k nearest neighbors. Let's say in my case, it can be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So let's say I say that, okay, let's see the 5 nearest neighbors. And based on the voting, I can tell that in which class this new data point belongs. Okay. And let's say a new data point like this. So this is what the neighbors are, okay? This is, let's say it can be n neighbors, but I have to take how many? 5 only, correct? Understanding this, what I'm trying to say? Okay, I'm repeating, wait. So let's say this is a point. So in my feature space, this is how the points looks like, correct? Now, if a new point arrives, right? Let's say this point. Now what I'm trying to see is what are its neighbors. So that is the reason I have just expanded it. You can say that I am zooming it, and let's say this is how it looks. This is the point, the green point, and around that, these are the neighbors. Each shape belongs to one class. So how many neighbors can you see here? Let's say one more.
Eight.
Let's say one more. How many now? Nine. Correct?
Yes.
Nine neighbors. So my manager is asking, or my client is asking, can you tell me the class of this point? So I'll say, see, in childhood, we used to be known by the company we used to keep. Similarly, my point will be known by the company it keeps. Correct? Okay. So my company obviously is people who are studious also, people who are good in games also, people who are very, not so good people, right? Those are also. But how will I judge how this person is? Based on its nearest neighbor. Okay. So what I'll do? So I'll calculate the distance of all the points from this particular point. And let's say I said I have to consider nine neighbors. Okay. So if I ask you that you have to choose your two nearest neighbors, so what will you do? In real sense, just assume that you are at your home and you have to choose two nearest neighbor. What will you do?
The neighbors who are nearby, we will consider.
So there is a way. First of all, what you will do is you will find out the distance from all the neighbors. See, you as a human being is smart, right? So you need not to calculate all the distance. You can simply get the smallest distance and then find out. But let's say how the algorithm will think. Algorithm will have to calculate all the distance, then only it can compare which one is nearby, which one is not. Tell me.
Yes.
In a feature space, if there are n points, so how many neighbors a point can have? No. Every point except itself will be a neighbor of this. Yeah. So if we have 100 points, how many neighbors can I have?
99.
Except that point, everyone is neighbor. But I have to take how many? Let's say I decide how I achieve this number. I'll come to that later. But let's assume that I'm saying that if you have to find out the class of this particular point, just take the nine nearest neighbors. Okay, so take nine nearest neighbors. How many? Nine. Okay, so I'm saying nine nearest neighbors. So obviously my algorithm would have find out the distance from this point to all other points and then sort it based on minimum to maximum. And and just took the nine nearest points. I mean, nine smallest distance point, rank 1 to 9, right? Correct? I've got. Now I have nine points on the basis of minimum to maximum. Like maximum means till ninth maximum. Okay. Clear? Now, once I have decided nine points, what is the class of this? Let's say this is nothing but class A. What is this? This is nothing but class B. What this denotes is nothing but class C. What this denote is class D. Any other shape we have? No. Okay. So let us say this is like that. Okay. So tell me, how many of the neighbors are belonging from class A?
Three.
How many are belonging from class B? How many are belonging from class 3?
Three.
How many are belonging from class D?
One.
Okay. So which is the maximum? This and this, right? So if you see, there is a tie, correct? What I can do is I can increase the number of neighbors. Now I'll take 10 or 11, let's say. 10 I won't take, I'll take 11. Why? Because the chances are more. If we take an even number of neighbors, the chances of having a tie is more. Let's say 11, and then it happened that 2 of this came. So if I'm taking 11, now how many are there? This became 5, all are same. So what is the probability of this is will be decided by the neighbor which is maximum in number to in neighbor. You understand? So what I mean to say is, for example, this class is maximum when I consider 11 neighbors, right? So I'll consider that my new point belongs to this class, that is class A. Clear? That means your point would be known by your company. Your company means if you have only two companies, I mean, if you have only two companies, or let's say all the, you know, all the data point around my new point belongs to a single class, then it is easier for us, right? That means this will also belong to that particular class only. But if it is from two different classes, then I'll take the majority. Similarly, if we have three, then also we'll talk in the terms of majority. Yes or no?
Yes.
You got, how will I select the class of a new data point? So basically, class of the new data point is nothing but the class of its neighbor. Highest, I mean, whoever holds the highest number of points in that particular class, in its neighbor, I'll consider that my new point will belong to that particular class only. Yes, no? Got it? Yes, no? Yes. Tell me.
Yes.
Okay, I'll take another example, and then it would be more clear, right? It would be more clear. Same type of example. Let's say now I have this, and now you guys will tell me, okay? Let's say I have class A, B, C, A, B, D, B, C, A, D, right? Like that. Now again here, let's say A. Now how many neighbors we have, total neighbors around this particular point?
11.
3, 3, 6, 3, 9 to 11, right? Now I am saying, just take what, 5 nearest neighbors. Wait, give me one moment. Let me number it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. What do you think is the nearest 5 neighbors of the point, R point?
4, 5, 7, 6, 8.
8. Huh? 4, 5. Nearest 5 neighbor. Can you tell me?
4, 5, 7, 6, 8.
Right? These are the 5 neighbors. What is the class of 4?
Yeah.
What is class of 5?
A.
What is class of 7?
B.
What is class of 6?
D.
What is class of 8?
C.
Okay. Which is the maximum, what is the majority class in the neighbors?
A.
Then what will be the class of my data point?
A.
Everyone, what will be the class of my data point?
A.
Any confusion in this?
No.
What if we had a tie? Let's say AA, B, and DD. Then?
Anyone we can write nearest.
No, not anyone. How can you write?
We go for 7
so you
nearest.
Will have to increase the neighbors, right? Or decrease the neighbors can also fetch you, right? But we usually increase the neighbors. Clear? Is this point clear? If this is clear, your whole KNN concept is clear.
Yes,
clear. Okay. Yes. Then comes, how will you find the nearest neighbor? See, it is very easy. If you understand from your real life scenario, now, if you relate it, it would be very easy. How did you find the nearest neighbor if you were an algorithm? So basically, I don't know which are the nearest, because in my eyes, you are able to figure out the nearest. But as an algorithm, I'll have to find out the distance from my unknown point or unknown class point to all the other points. So altogether 12 points we have, 11 plus 1 this point, and 11 neighbors. So how many distance pairs we'll have? 11, right?
11.
With respect to our point, I'm not interested in knowing with respect to other data point. So how many distance we'll have?
11.
11. So 9, 10, and 11, right? So one denotes the distance of one from my data point, right? Two denotes the distance. So this way I find out the distance. So D1, D2 up to the D11. That is the first step. What is the second step? What is the second step?
How many nearest?
The nearest neighbors.
Sorting and finding nearest.
Wait. Second step is sorting, right? Second step is sorting. D udhar hi reh gaya. Okay, wait. Yeah. Paste it here also. Okay. Now let's say this was D1, D2, D3, and up to the D11. See, this D1 doesn't mean that this distance is maximum, right? But we have to sort. Then what we have to do? Sort smallest to highest, right? And then take what? First k distances. Because those are my nearest neighbors, yes or no?
Yes.
Right.
But we defined what is the value of k. I said 5. We are coming to that, how to find out the nearest neighbor, what should be the number of nearest neighbors, right? But for now, just assume that I decided, correct? So once I said 5, that means I have to first of all sort and then take the 5 distance, right? So let's say sorted value looks something like this. What do we say? 4, 5, 7, 6, 8, right? So let's say sorted value looks something like. So now 5 we have to take only, right? So let's say 1 and 4, correct? So 5. Now 4, 5, 7, 6, 8 is what? 4, 5, 7, 6, 8. Okay. So let's say this is 4, 5, 7, 6, 8. Okay. Rest I haven't considered, right? This is D min, right? This is D min 2, right? D min 3, D min 4, D min 5, where D min is the minimum distance. Okay. That means it is the first nearest neighbor, second, third, fourth, fifth, right? Out of this, I'll find out what is the class of it, and then we'll try to vote whichever class is going to be maximum out of all the neighbors. All the neighbors means as many as I have chose for this particular algorithm, right? I can choose 5, 7, 9. Usually we take odd numbers, because the chance, if you take odd numbers, the chance of having a tie is less, yes or no? No rocket science. This is just mathematics, right? If you have odd number, usually one will be more. I mean, if you divide it into two, so one class will be more than another. The chances are more. Still, we get a tie, like the way we did here, right? We got a tie. Yes or no? Here, right? Here we had 9 nearest neighbors. Then also we had a tie. Yes or no? Hello.
Yes.
You got this point, what I'm trying to explain? Sometimes yes. It happens, but the chances are less. If you take, you know, even number of points, the chances are more. That's all. I'm not saying that it won't happen when we take odd number. That is the reason in the first example itself I showed you, so that you are not confused and you don't answer this in interview. Some people say that when we take odd number of neighbors, we can never happen to occur the tie. The tie can never never occur, right? That is what people say in the interview, which is not true, right? It can still happen, correct? Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
If it can happen, that means just for the sake of avoid, in most of the cases, we are taking the odd number. Got my point? Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now, just couple of points before we go ahead. Lot of space left. Just not looking good. I cannot convert it right. So let it be like this. No need to worry. Okay. Before I go ahead, let us see some point. So how it is selecting the class of a new data point you got?
Yes.
Is it necessary to mention that how it is supervised learning? Because we already know the class of all the other points except this point. Yes or no? We know that the class of one is B, class of second is C, which was not available for us in clustering. Here we have, and that is the reason it is supervised learning. And we know the class, that is the reason it is a classification problem. Correct? Now, this is called a lazy learner, right? Lazy learner. Like you guys are lazy learner, this is also lazy learner. Okay? How is it called a lazy learner? Okay, let me use another color, because this is very important. This is actually an interview question. Why is KNN called a lazy learner? Understand it properly. And this is very easy. So what I'm saying is, how does it actually train? Okay, every model trains. Now, how is it training is, actually what happens is, at the time of training, what this algorithm or KNN does is, it memorizes the data points. That means it memorizes the distance matrix also, right? So what it actually happens is, for example, let's say if I have this feature space, right? So it actually memorizes all the data points, right? And now, since there is no data point which I want to calculate, it may come at later phase. Yes, no?
Yes.
Yes.
Let's say if I have the map of whole city, without you telling me that the reference point is here, how can I tell you the distance? I cannot tell, right? So in that way, I have to just keep the map in my mind. And at the point when you will ask, tell me the distance from this particular point, then only I can calculate the distance. Yes, no?
Yes.
Again, I'm repeating. So let's say this point is of which I want to calculate the class, but this point, till this point is not here. So let's say I'm talking about my feature space, right? So all the training data, which has already defined as a class, right, is present here like this, correct? Now when unseen data will come, then only I'll be able to find out the distance from that unseen data to each point. Yes, no?
Right.
The unseen data point may appear anywhere, may appear here or here or here or here or in between. Yes, no?
Yes.
But before that data point appears, can I calculate the distance or n nearest neighbors?
No.
No.
Till the time I tell you that you have to find out the n nearest neighbor of Ram, then only you will find out, right? You cannot find out before I tell you whose neighbor you have to find out.
Right.
So that is the reason at the time of training, it memorizes the data points, right? And finding the nearest neighbor happens at prediction time. So at the time you are predicting, you will pass the data point for which you are predicting, let's say test data set. So the moment it will see the data or the test data, then it will, for each data point, it will try to find out the neighbors, the distance of the neighbors, and then sorting the distance and finding the n nearest neighbors or k nearest neighbors. That means whole thing happens at prediction time, calculation. Only the memory, the memorization happens at the training phase. Clear? You understand? And why it is happening so, you know, correct? Because without data reference point, I cannot calculate the distance. In order to calculate the distance, we need to have a reference point. Yes, no, tell me.
Yes.
Yes.
And since I don't have a reference point at training, that is the reason the moment I'll get the data point for which I have to calculate the class or I have to tell the class, then only I'll be able to calculate the neighbors from that point. No? Yes, no, maybe.
Right. Right.
So let me write it down for you so that you are able to understand later or read it from later what we studied. And it should be 100% understood. This is a very good question that they asked, right? So I'm writing. At the time of training, it memorizes this particular algorithm, memorizes the data points and basically finding the nearest neighbors are done at prediction time. When? At prediction time. Hence, first of all, it is called lazy learner. Kind of you can think it in a way that it is too lazy to do it at the training time. Reason we know, but just for naming convention, I'm telling. That is the reason it is called as lazy. How you define a lazy person? It will keep on postponing till it becomes necessary. That is the definition of lazy.
Yes.
And that is what this algorithm is doing. Correct? So can I sum up in one line that minimal training, right, but expensive learning? Hello?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I thought my internet was. Clear? Can I sum up the whole thing in one phrase? Minimal training, but expensive learning. Because in training, what is happening? Nothing. We are just keeping a track of the data points, or at least the coordinates, if you want to keep it in that sense. Yes, no?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Understood? So if you understood this, that is about the algorithm, but there is a thing or two that you need to understand before it goes. Okay. How will you find the similarity matrix? How will you find the similarity or the distance between or the n nearest neighbors based on the distance? So basically, right? Basically, let us see how it works. Working, we have written on what? I think I have explained this. Okay. Then let's talk about some distance metrics. Okay. Now we are going to talk about two distance metrics, Euclidean and Manhattan distance. Right, there you can think of multiple, there are multiple more distances, right? But usually 90% of the time Euclidean distance are used. Sometime Manhattan distance are also used. That is the reason I'm explaining these two. Okay, Euclidean distance is nothing but Pythagoras theorem. So if you have to find out this is A, this is B, let's say this is C, you have to find out AB. So AB is nothing but AC square plus BC square, right, under root. All of you know this. Anyone who doesn't know this particular formula? Tell me.
We know.
So coordinates, when you talk about the coordinates, usually x distance is given, right? Y distance is given. So it is easier for you to calculate the distance between them with the help of x coordinate, y coordinate. Correct? That is the reason we use Euclidean distance. Now let's see what is Manhattan distance. Now you understand that this is the shortest distance between A and B.
Yes.
This is the shortest. Euclidean distance is the shortest distance. This is sometimes also called city block, right? City block distance. Now just imagine, and even the name Manhattan is a city. Yes or no? Are bolo na, yes.
Yes.
That is the reason we are taking a reference, as always in data science, from any other field. So let's say Manhattan is a city, just in order to remember that this matrix is called as, or this particular distance metric calculation is called as Manhattan distance. City block is also it is called. Now, when is it used? For example, let's say if the shortest distance is not possible. For example, let's take an example of in real life scenario. Let's say if you are a person A and another person B, right? And you know, there is this, you know, there is this let's say, correct, there is one river going like this. So your friend is at A and you are at B, right? So shortest distance, is it possible? How will you go from helicopter from point A to point B? You cannot go. Yes, no. Tell me.
Yes.
Yes, no. Correct. Then how will you reach B? So shortest distance is not possible, right? That means we have to think in some other, you know, some other technique in which we are able to find out the distance between these two. Usually if you see Google Maps, in Google Map always you know, shortest distance we don't take, correct? We in a way we take practical distance. Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay, and that is the reason we are talking about this. So in city what actually happens is shortest distance is not always possible, right? So let me make it easy for you and let me draw, and the real life example is Google Maps. So in Google Maps what actually happens is it is based on the possible you can say possible path that is from A to B, right? That it will take that particular route. Clear? So let's say if this is the block, right, and if I have to go, this is from point A to point B, right? Point B. So as you can see, right, this particular distance is not possible. बोलो
नो इट्स नॉट पॉसिबल
नॉट पॉसिबल राइट सो व्हाट इज द थिंग दैट वी कैन यू नो वी कैन थिंक ऑफ राइट सो दिस इज द डिस्टेंस लेट्स से राइट दिस 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 राइट एंड let's say we skip two and go there right this is the distance another way is going from here to here and here to here right or going here then reaching out here going here reaching out here going here reaching out here and then like this so there can be multiple such combinations possible
yes
right so in a way right whenever the shortest distance is not possible what is the nearest see this is also not perfect because I so why is it called a city block assuming if you see everything in data science is very intuitive so let's say there is a home there right and there is a home here right and there is a home here so in between I think that yes there is some space to go right so you can cross it like this or you can cross it like this or you can cross it like this so let's say this is house number 1 2 3 so you can cross in between 1 2 2, 3, 3, 4, like that, and you can choose any path. Yes or no? So if you see, in a way, how is it possible? So it is nothing but summation of y2 minus y1 plus x2 minus x1. So basically, we are taking the absolute path, correct? So why I'm taking this absolute path, plus up to the it can go, right? Why I'm taking this absolute path is because shortest path is not possible. So I have to take care, let's say if I am going like this, so I have to take care of this path and I have to calculate what is the distance. So absolute distance, correct? Shortest distance is not possible. And that is the reason we use this. So Manhattan distance is obviously with some tweaking is used in Google Maps. Correct? Yeah. All you have to do is shorten the cell. That way it is very easy to be very real or be very near to the real time taken or real distance covered. Got my point?
Yes.
Right? So in that way it is covered. So see, formula is not so important, right? Formula is not so important, but right. So if I have to write even the formula, so how will you write? This is nothing but AI minus BI and summation throughout the I, right? Okay. Now I is the cell. How many cells that you have crossed, right? And throughout, let's say two dimensions, right? If the dimensions may increase, you can increase it even further. But you don't have to worry about this. Right, you can just you can just initiate it at the time that which particular distance matrix you want to cover, and it will take care of that. Is it clear? They may ask you, why do you use Manhattan distance, right? What is the difference, right? In real life, can you explain when we will use Manhattan distance and when we will use Euclidean distance? Would you be able to tell? Bolo, yes, no.
Yes.
Okay. Now, I think we have already discussed the steps, right? So I haven't listed the steps, but I think you can write, okay, how it was working, right? So only three steps. You just tell the value of k neighbors. It will, the moment you will feed the data, it will find out the distance from that data point to all the other data points. And then in next step, it will sort the data, and based on the value of k, it will find out the k nearest neighbors, right? And it will try to find out what is the class of each data point or k data point. And then it will take the voting from the maximum, right? And voting as per the voting, it will assign the class of the maximum votes as the class of your data point. Is it clear?
Yes.
Now comes the very $1 million question, right? $1 million question. And this you guys will guess first, and then we are going to start, right? Finding the value of K. Right value of K. Okay. So optimum value of K. How is it going to be? Tell me. Guess right.
Depends.
You know everything, correct?
Odd number.
Huh? Odd number, right? So
yes.
first thing to keep in mind that the usually, right, K should be odd. The reason is to avoid a tie in class voting. Right? What else? See, this is a classification. So you will obviously take help from accuracy, precision, recall, right? Or whatever you want, F1 score, whatever you want. So you can have a range of K and then decide. Based on evaluation matrix. Yes or no? Bolo na yaar. Let's say I can start with K is equal to 1. I can go till 100 and then I can find what at which particular value of K I'm getting a better accuracy or for my for my data set or for my problem, I'm interested in precision, then wherever I'm getting the best precision, best recall, F1 score, something like that. Correct? That is also can be there.
Yes. Yes.
Right.
The third point. Usually, this is just a thumb rule, right? Just a thumb rule. Again, not can be, you cannot always use it, but still a thumb rule, right? Usually they say optimal value, right? Just a thumb rule. Optimal value of K is under root of N, right? N is the total number of samples, right? For example, if the samples are 100, so you can take N as 10, around 10. So under root of 100 is 10, but we have to take odd, so we will take 9 or 11. Clear? Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay. Another thing is, what else? Avoid very small value, right? Very small value. The error will be less, right? Let's say if I'm taking a neighbor is equal to 1. So at K is equal to 1, which is nothing but your nearest neighbor. So it is going to be 100% right, because that is the nearest neighbor, right? So only one class is there, no voting, nothing, right? So avoid very small value of K. Correct?
Right.
Okay, do not ask me what is the small. It is up to you. Correct? Now, the most important thing. The fifth way. I am just dealing with five or six we will be dealing with. Even if you remember two, you can tell. Right? Remember two, you can tell. Okay. Any other guesses what we can do?
Do RC using for multi-class classification?
Huh? For any class. See, multi-class is what we discussed, right? How many classes we had here? How many classes we had?
Four.
So this is multi-class, right?
Yeah.
Correct. So no need to worry, because here it is voting. Based on voting, we are deciding. Doesn't matter how many class it is, right? See, you understand? If there is a small value of k, what will happen? That means you have captured noise, right? Large value of k means computationally very complex, expensive, right? So you can use this thumb rule as one thing. Another thing is you can decide based on the right, based on the error versus number of k. Let's say this is my k value, right? K value, and this is nothing but error rate. So if this is a problem of, see, you understand, in clustering we cannot find out the error, because we are not working with supervised learning. But here we can assess whether my classification is correct or not. Yes or no?
Yes.
So here I can assess, right? Let's say at some point of at some point, let's say if it started from 1, so 10, 20, 30, like that. So at some point, wherever I want, I need to be settled down with that particular error. Correct. Let's say it is 0.2, 0.8, something like that. Here it is 2.0. So at some point of time, let's say if I want very less, right, around this, so I can settle down with this. So based on that, we would be working out with this optimum value. Again, optimum value selection is up to you, right? Up to you which value we are going to select. Okay, that we are going to see in the our data set also. But is it clear, the five different ways?
Yes.
In most of the case, you can go ahead with the thumb rule, right? That is what it will help you. But let's say if you are thinking of increasing or decreasing, right, you can also take help from error rate versus k value. And another thing is you can write a loop in which you can run the value of k in a particular range, and then you can see how your accuracy is changing at a particular value of k. Clear? Okay, so that is about KNN. This is very related to K-means. Okay, can someone tell me what is the difference between K-means and KNN? Difference between
K-means is clustering for unsupervised learning. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
KNN is used for supervised learning.
KNN is used for supervised learning and is used for classification. Right?
Yeah. Yes.
What else? What else? अरे कुछ तो बोलो. Okay. Tell me one thing. Tell me one thing. Which okay. See, whenever someone asks you to differentiate between these two, do not just give differentiation based on the definition or how it works. Let's say after one point you don't have anything to say, then at least try to explain it. Correct? You just now know K-means also, and you just now studied K-nearest neighbors also, right? So you can just explain the gist in two or three lines. Correct? Okay. What is the advantage and disadvantage of KNN? What is the advantage? First of all, it is easy to understand. Right?
Yes.
And even for multi-class classification, there is no such complexity involved. Right? I'm talking about in the terms of multi-class versus binary class. It just takes the same thing. It has to take the vote and maximum vote. Okay, whether it is binary or multi, it doesn't care. Correct?
Yes.
But what is the, you can say, drawbacks of KNN or cons of KNN? First of all, it is very memory intensive, computationally very, very expensive. Why? Because at prediction time, it will calculate the distance, right? And then it will sort. Then it will take the voting, right? First of all, it will do the sampling. That means out of all the distance, it will take k nearest. And then it will take the voting out of that. And then it will assign the class to your data point. So this is memory intensive, correct? Yes. Since it is also using the distance matrix, so it is obviously what? Sensitive to the scale. So scaling we have to correct, yes or no? See, always remember, in any algorithm, if distance matrix is involved, you have to scale the data properly. You got my point?
Yes.
Okay. So these are some things, right? These are some things which are pros and cons of this, okay? And yes, obviously, like cross validation, you can use here also, right? Cross validation, and then we are going to see with the help of cross validation. Any confusion in this? Tell me, any confusion?
No.
Okay, cool. So this is the easiest of all algorithm, right, to understand. And it has, I usually teach it with KNN so that there is no confusion. Now, would you guys get confused in when someone asks you the difference between K-means and KNN? You should not. Correct?
No.
So always remember, they will try to confuse you that how do you find the value of k in both, right? You have to tell. Correct? It is easier here because we can calculate the error, accuracy, precision, recall, F1, AUC, all those things. True positive, true negative, right? True positive rate, true negative rate, right? PR curve also we can see. AUC of PR curve, right? Precision recall curve, basically. All those things you know, right? In depth. So, right. Since it is a classification, we can use those concepts here. Correct?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Let's go ahead straightforwardly to the, the code. Okay. So, K nearest neighbor, we are using with a cross validation technique. Okay. Now, again, we are going to import libraries. Right, import libraries here, getting the data. So classified data here, understand this. As I always say, that sometimes you won't be able to understand the data. Here, it's the data itself is classified. We are not able to understand what is this data says about. Okay, what this data says about. Okay, so let's say this is one column, another, and even the name is very strange. Okay, then what is left? We need to standardize the data. As I said, in all the algorithm, wherever distance matrix is used or distance is being calculated in the working of that algorithm, there you will standardize the variable. Why we do standardize, you know, right? Because all are in same standard, and then one cannot be neglected in front of other, right? The weights are same, right? And you know, sklearn preprocessing, import standard scalar, instantiate it, fit it, right? And then you transform it. Okay, after that, this is a transform data. Okay, then we try to see pair plot. Can someone tell me why do we use pair plot?
Multiple variables are being listed.
Relationship between basically two variables.
To know the correlation.
Yes, kind of that. Okay, so relationship basically. Okay, so pair plot, you can plot another plot also. See, I try to give you as many variations as possible. So even if you remember the splitting I have shown with two or three methods, right? So that if a new way you see, you don't get surprised. Okay. But these pair plots and all you would have studied in Python, you might have forgot. So I thought, let me remind you so that you are able to understand that at any point we have to use any plot, right? We may have to, sometimes we have to use bar, sometimes we have to histogram, sometimes box plot usually use every time. Okay, so if you do end to end, you will use that because you have to work with outlier, you have to see the IQR, you have to see the range, right? In general, you have to compare two samples or two different values or two different columns for that matter, right? Then you use box plot. Okay, minimum to minimum, maximum to maximum, median to median, right? Like that. Here, now going ahead, train test split. What is the train test split ratio here?
70-30.
Okay, now if you see here, I have tried to give it in a different way earlier. Sometimes what you can do is, even before train test split, you can make a variable X and Y. Sometimes you can simply give a column, right? You can assign that column to Y, right? So DF target class is nothing but my Y. What that target class itself is written right here. Okay, clear? And now while doing standardization, we have always remember, don't standardize your target variable, right? You have to do for only the independent variable. Why not target variable? Because it contains the two classes. If 1 and 0, it will convert it into 0.02 and something like that, then it would be not good for you, correct?
Yeah.
Again, using KNN. So I'll just import KNeighbors classifier from sklearn neighbors. Okay, I'll instantiate, and currently I'm looking by just putting n neighbors is equal to 1. Further, what I'll do is I'll try to increase the neighbors. So I'm fitting the neighbor and I'm predicting, right? Let's see the evaluation, right? Once I'm predicting, I'm looking at the evaluation. This is how the evaluation matrix looks like. And what is the number of neighbors? What is the value of K?
1.
Why you guys are getting confused? If n neighbors is 1, that means number of neighbors we have selected as 1. That means what is the value of K?
1.
In this particular case, it is 1. And then we have try to find out the classification report. This is confusion matrix. So see, the precision came out to be 88% for 0, right? For 1, it is 86%, correct? Recall F1 score. And this is how it looks. It is even at k is equal to 1, it is looking good, right? But we have to see what is the optimum value of K, right? Then there can be multiple ways. One way is to look from accuracy rate. Another way is to look from error rate. Obviously, I'll select the value of K where my accuracy is high. Yes, no?
Yes.
Or my error is low. Yes, no?
Yes.
Right?
Yep.
So I have just copied and pasted here. Just to give you an idea, you can use any. Both the things are same in a way, right? Here I'm using cross-validation tenfold, right? So that it is able to take, and then I'm plotting, right? Plotting. So if you see at, obviously I have said that lesser value of K, I don't have to, take, right? So I'll take around in between, I can see around 15 to 30, around that. There I'm seeing around 20 to 23, 22 is getting the minimum error. Sorry, this is accuracy. So what is the better accuracy? So this is where the accuracy is better. Let's say it is 22 or 23 or 21. I don't know, right? Correct? Similarly, I can just plot, this is accuracy, but I can plot error rate also.
Yes.
That will be just exactly opposite. The concept is same. I'll take the value of K where it should not be very less. It should not be very high. And my accuracy should also be at least locally good. Correct?
Yes.
Or if I'm looking at the error, then error should be less. So if this is accuracy, I did not see, I thought it is an error. So if it is accuracy, so obviously I won't take the minimum, I'll take the maximum locally, right? So around around here after 12 and till 35, I cannot take this value and this value. This is less, this is more. So I'll have to take in this range. In this range, I can see that around here, 20 to 22 is the maximum. Yes or no? Bolo, yes, no.
Yeah.
This again is depends. Even if you want to take, you can go ahead with 32, right? 32, but you have to understand under root of n is the thumb rule. If your sample size is 900 or more, then only you can take the chance to go ahead with more than 30. Clear? That is a thumb rule there. So let's say I decided to go ahead with, go ahead with around 20, 21, 22. Okay. So let's say this is my k is equal to 1, right? K is equal to 1. And this is, let's say I can take 20, 21, 22, 23 based on you. Let's say I take 20 as k neighbor, right? So this is my new confusion matrix. This is my precision. You see, it increased. Earlier, what it was? 88, 86. Now it is 92, 93. Correct? Now just change. You can further change the value of k and see the accuracy, right? But it should not be in the cost of overfitting. Got my point? Any yeah. confusion till here? How I have selected the value of k?
No confusion.
Thumb rule, under root of n, where n is the number of sample. Let's say you have 900 data points, 30 should be around 30. You can start from 25 to 35. You can see what around that, what is the maximum minimum, correct?
Correct.
So a combination of both, you can use it to select the value of k. Till here, any confusion you may ask. Any confusion, guys?
No.
Okay, if no confusion, then please explain what is going on here.
We are trying to see which, basically getting a list of accuracies for k values ranging from 1 to 40.
Mm-hmm. And then that is the very first line. After that, what is happening? You can try, it's fine even if you are at fault. Try na, at least you started, at least finish it. Have some confidence, you know these things. So we have instantiated our model, right? And I'm saying I have to use the n neighbors is equal to I. That means in the first iteration or first loop, I'm using n neighbors is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 till 40. Okay, clear? This first line is clear. In second line, which is the most important line, I'm saying my score is based on cross validation. So how does the cross validation work? One sample I will use for testing, all others for training. How many time I'll do? As many as is it is the fold. So if I'm using 10 fold cross validation, then what it will be?
10 times.
So my basically my score will be 10 scores. So the output is going to be 10. So I have to take the mean of that. Accuracy is nothing but the mean of the score, right? And if I have to take the error, which is nothing but 1 minus accuracy.
Yes.
So yes. That is for error, I'm taking 1 minus score, mean of score, where score is nothing but my accuracy score. Got my point?
Right.
And that is what I'm doing. Once I have got it, is it very tough for us to make a list and relate it with the value of k and what is the error rate or accuracy rate at that point? यस नो बोलो.
यस.
ओके, नाउ दैट ब्रिंग्स मी टू माय सेकंड असाइनमेंट फॉर टुडे. What you have to do is, I have plotted accuracy. What you can do is, you can plot the error rate, okay? And you can try out with multiple other values of k. Let's say that I have taken 20. You just see what will happen if I take the value of k is equal to around, this is 32, 34. Just try to find out the maximum, right? Accuracy, where is it maximum? Exact point, try to find out without worrying about if it is should be the value of k or not. Without worrying that, just try to find out at what point it is maximum. Can you do that?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, that should be your second assignment. What was the first assignment I gave?
Study about linkage methods.
Linkage method, word linkage and all. It is, I just gave you a hint. It is related to the similarity matrix, mostly in the terms of distance. Okay. Cool. So yeah, that's all for today. Okay, that's all for today. K nearest neighbor is the easiest one. If someone wants to keep it in their resume or in their and write it as a project, it is the easiest algorithm to explain. Okay, but you have to keep a track and you have to get through this question. How did you select value of k in the real time? Just bombard with all the methods that I have taught you. Okay. Two or three, even if you remember, then also it is fine, but you have to be convincing enough, right? Do not answer in a way that you are explaining a project. You have to explain like you are speaking that on behalf of a product. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah. So that's all for today. Okay. And before I break, so yes, I'll tell Apurva to schedule a class tomorrow. She has said that in this account, from this particular account, there is that 7 to 9, 8 to 10 p.m. is already blocked. Okay, so you see 8 to 10 p.m. is blocked. So we cannot have the class on this particular link. So she will try to send some other link. So either on Monday or Tuesday, right? So we'll try to do on Monday, but based on the availability of these things, she will schedule. Okay, so keep an eye on that. Do not assume that we have to join here. If you join here, then no one will be here, right? So yes, keep that thing in mind. Any other questions, concern?
Dhruv, one question. Here you said that for the highest accuracy rate, that is between 30 to 35. Mm-hmm. I didn't get that. You said that we are not supposed to choose that, something like.
You did not get, but why you did not get? I said, if you remember, yeah, this is R. What I said as a thumb rule, optimal value of k should be under root of n, right?
Yeah.
Correct? So let's say, If my data set is around 900 to 1000, then only I can take the value of k as high as 30.
Yes.
Just a thumb rule I'm saying, okay? Even if you, and that is what I have given as an assignment, right? You can go ahead and take, but I'm saying that everything that you decide will bring on to with itself some complexity. Right, some overfitting, some underfitting, that you have to, and that is the reason we are focusing on an optimal value, right? Correct. But what is the optimal value? It should be in the range of under root of n, around that. 2-3 here and there we can do tweaking, but we have to keep a maryada of under root of n. And what is that? Let's say if my sample size is n, which is 900, then only I can take around 30. Or 1000, then also I can take 30.
Yes.
Correct. If my sample size is 500, what value of n can I choose? Tell me. 20 to 25?
Yes.
So that we have to keep a track. Okay. So whenever you will find out under root of n, and you have, okay, under root of n you will do, you will get a number. Keep that number as reference, and around that number, try to find out wherever you are getting a good accuracy. That should be your optimal value of clusters.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, yeah. So that is a suggestion. Otherwise, for starters, we are anyway starting from clusters I is equal to 1, yes or no?
Yes.
So it is out in the open where what you want to use. I just told you these are the things that we keep a track. Okay. Got this?
Yes.
Okay. So let me save it. Have I saved this? I saved it. Let me see. Okay, so yeah, that's all for today, guys. If you have any question, quickly you may ask. Otherwise, you may leave.